Shri Advaita Gadadhar Shiva Sarigaur Bhaktivedanta Ki Jai. Shri Shri Radha Krishna Gopa Gopinatha Shama Kunda Radha Kunda Giri Govardhan Ki Jai. Shri Vrindavan Dham Ki Jai. Mayapur Navadvip Dham Ki Jai. Jagannath Puri Ki Jai. Ganga Mayi Ki Jai. Jamuna Mayi Ki Jai. Bhakti Devi Ki Jai. Tulsi Maharani Ki Jai. Samaveda Bhaktivedanta Ki Jai. All glories to the assembled devotees. All glories to the assembled devotees. All glories to the assembled devotees. All glories to Shri Shri Guru Angaranga. All glories to Srila Prabhupada. Today we're continuing the reading of Srila Prabhupada Lilamrita, written by His Holiness Satsarup Das Goswami. This is volume 2, and we're starting chapter 3 today, entitled Struggling Alone. This first slide is after last week's class, our dear godbrother Bhumipati Prabhu and his wife Chaitanya Dasi, they found a book that has 17 of Prabhupada's letters that he wrote at this time from America. So this is the letter that we read last week, addressed to the Gaudiya Math, Bhaktivedanta Narayan Maharaj. We studied that during the class last week. And you can see here, Prabhupada, he has most of it in Bengali. And then when he was describing the newspaper article, he put that into English. So now, Prabhupada has left Butler. He's left Philadelphia. He's boarded the bus to go to New York City. It's an hour and a half ride from Philadelphia. And this is Prabhupada in a conversation. He's speaking about what happened when he reached New York. I used to sit in the back and listen to his meetings silently. He was speaking all impersonal nonsense, and I kept my silence. Then one day he asked if I would like to speak, and I spoke about Krishna consciousness. I challenged that he was speaking manufactured philosophy and all nonsense from Shankaracharya. He tried to back out and said he was not speaking. Shankaracharya was speaking. I said, "You are representing him. That is the same thing." He then said to me, "Swamiji, I like you very much, but you cannot speak here. But although our philosophies differed, and he would not let me speak, he was kind, and I was nice to him." So this Prabhupada is speaking here about his sponsor in New York City. He had never met Dr. Ramamurti Mishra, but he had a letter of introduction from one Paramananda Mehra, who Prabhupada had met in Bombay. Prabhupada knew no one in New York, but he had a contact, Dr. Ramamurti Mishra. He had written Dr. Mishra from Butler. Enclosing the letter of introduction Paramananda Mehra had given him in Bombay. He had also phoned Dr. Mishra, who welcomed Prabhupada to join him in New York. At the Port Authority bus terminal, a student of Dr. Mishra's met him as he arrived from Philadelphia and escorted him directly to an Indian festival in the city. There, Prabhupada met Dr. Mishra, as well as Ravi Shankar and his brother, the dancer, Uday Shankar. Prabhupada then accompanied Dr. Mishra to his apartment at 33 Riverside Drive beside the Hudson River. The apartment was on the 14th floor and had large windows overlooking the river. Dr. Mishra gave Prabhupada a room to himself. So this is a picture of Dr. Ramamurti Mishra, the ashram founder, Sri Brahmananda Saraswati. So Brahmananda Saraswati was his sannyas name. And when Prabhupada met him, Dr. Ramamurti Mishra was not yet wearing his sannyas attire. He was a highly respected spiritual teacher for countless students and devotees from all walks of life. a prolific author on the ancient science and philosophy of yoga and Vedanta. He combined the universal message of these teachings with his deep knowledge of both Eastern and Western medicine and psychology, ranging from Ayurveda to the areas of modern psychiatry and neurosurgery. So, Dr. Mishra, he was born in Kashi, and his father was a Sanskrit scholar also, Brahmin family. But at the age of 6, he contracted a very serious disease, and he died. And for 36 hours, he was dead. So as is the custom, he was brought to the Ganga, and he was placed there for burning the body. His father had the fire in his hand, and he was circumambulating the sun. And then the sun sat up. And everyone became so frightened, they thought a ghost that had entered him. So that everyone ran away except for the father. And the father asked him, of course they spoke in Hindi, he said, "Who are you?" And he said, "Father, it's me." So the boy had come back to life after 36 hours, and he considers that the time when he was actually born. So he left his home at an early age of 18, to study Sanskrit, yoga, the teachings of Shankaracharya. And then later he also became a doctor. So he went to America to complete his medical training. And there he worked in hospitals. In fact, there was the biggest mental hospital at that time in New York City, Bellevue Hospital, where Kirtananda had been sent. When he went to the draft, we had heard about this a few months ago, when they were trying to put all the young men into the army, he went dressed as a devotee in dhoti and kurta with sikha, and they put him in the mental hospital. So that was the same hospital, very big hospital in New York. And he gave up his practice because he had started the Yoga Society of America, and he was getting more and more students. Now, this we've heard about Port Authority Bus Terminal before, and the disciple who Dr. Mishra sent to meet Prabhupada was one of his young female disciples. And we will hear from her because these interviews with her and others were not available at the time that this book was written. So we'll hear more about her meeting with Srila Prabhupada. Aside from that, this Indian festival that she drove Prabhupada to, at that time there was a lot of cultural exchange between India and America, and there was a fusion of the dance and music. Now, of course, in our generation, Ravi Shankar was very famous because he met with the Beatles, and his music, he played sitar. His music became very famous, and he also composed the music for the great movie called Gandhi. So he was internationally famous. But he was the last of 7 brothers, and his eldest brother is mentioned here, Uday Shankar. Uday Shankar was born in 1900, just around the same time as Srila Prabhupada. And he was a dancer. And he, during that generation, was much more famous. He would travel all over Europe and America, putting on dance performances, and he had a troupe in different countries, France and England and America and India. So the two brothers together, although they were 20 years apart, they were both here in New York City at this time for this festival. And after the festival, Dr. Mishra very kindly invited Prabhupada to live in his apartment along with him. He gave Prabhupada his own room. We'll see pictures of that. Here we just have a little description we're not going to go into the impersonal philosophy that Dr. Mishra was teaching, but it's a real mishmash. And one of Prabhupada's earliest disciples, we'll read about it in a few pages, but just so you can understand how misguided these poor students were, his name was Harvey Cohen, and he came to one of the classes of Dr. Mishra, and he just couldn't meditate on that round circle there. he just couldn't put his mind into it, so he left the meditation program. Prabhupada later came to his room and began speaking with him, and he became Haridas, who later sponsored Prabhupada after Prabhupada had his stroke at Stinson Beach. It was his house. And he also arranged for Prabhupada to stay in the Bowery. So although Prabhupada, as Prabhupada mentions here in this conversation, Dr. Mishra was afraid to allow Prabhupada to speak. But at the end of each of Dr. Mishra's classes, he would allow Prabhupada to lead kirtan. And those kirtans would often go on for 1 hour, and he would have everybody dancing with him. Even Dr. Mishra loved the kirtans. So one little quote here so that we just have a little idea of what Prabhupada was up against. Every individual is the moving image of the universe. Therefore, every individual is potentially a miniature universe, the microcosm. By disciplining oneself in a natural way, one can realize the whole universe within oneself. So these poor students were just being misguided, and fortunately, Prabhupada came to help them. And many of them did start attending Prabhupada's classes. This is the 33 Riverside Drive. It was a posh apartment building. He lived on the 14th floor, which was just one floor under the penthouse. It had a doorman, and you enter in like that, and it overlooked the Hudson River. Now, that it would have been very nice, but the river was just like a big sewer at that time. But it was a nice part of town, and Dr. Mishra was very kind to allow Prabhupada to stay with him in such a nice location. Dr. Mishra was a dramatic, showy personality given to flashing glances and making expressive gestures with his hands. He regularly used words like lovely and beautiful. Presenting an artfully polished image of what a guru should be, he was what some New Yorkers referred to as an uptown swami. Before coming to America, Dr. Mishra had been a Sanskrit scholar and a guru, as well as a doctor. He had written a number of books, such as The Textbook of Yoga Psychology and Self-Analysis and Self-Knowledge, a work based on the teachings of the monistic philosopher Shankar. After he came to the United States, he continued with his medical profession, but as he began taking disciples, he gradually dropped his practice. Although a sannyasi, he did not wear the traditional saffron dhoti and kurta, but instead wore tailored Nehru jackets and white slacks. His complexion was dark, whereas Prabhupada's was golden, and he had thick black hair. At 44, he was young enough to be Prabhupada's son. Dr. Mishra had been suffering from bad health when Srila Prabhupada came into his life, and Prabhupada's arrival seemed the perfect medicine. So this is what Ramamurti Mishra has to say about Srila Prabhupada. His Holiness, Prabhupada Bhaktivedanta Goswamiji, really knocked me down with love. He was really an incarnation of love. My body had become a skeleton, and he really brought me back to life, his cooking, and especially his love and his devotion to Lord Krishna. I was very lazy in the matter of cooking, but he would get up and have ready. Dr. Mishra appreciated that Prabhupada cooking with the precision of a chemist would prepare many dishes, and that he had a gusto for eating. Ramamurti Mishra continues, "It was not bread he gave me. He gave me prasadam. This was life, and he saved my life. At that time, I was not sure I would live, but his habit to eat on time, whether I was hungry or not, that I very much liked. He'd get up and say, 'All right, this is Bhagwat Prasadam.' And I would say, 'All right.'" So now Satsrup Maharaj introduces one of Dr. Mishra's disciples. Joan Suval, an old student of Dr. Mishra's, often saw Srila Prabhupada and her teacher together at the Riverside Drive apartment. So Joan remembers here, "I have a memory of Swamiji as a child, in the sense of his being very innocent, a very simple person, very pure. The impression I have from Dr. Mishra is that he regarded Swamiji as a father figure who was kindly and good. But basically, the words most often used referring to Swamiji were, 'like a child,' meaning that he was simple in a classical, beautiful sense. Dr. Mishra mentioned to me when I was first introduced to Swamiji that he was a very holy man, very religious, wrapped in God consciousness. Swamiji was very sweet. I myself remember him as a very, very good man, even in the practical details of living in New York, which seemed to involve him very much, because he was a practical man and was looking for the best place to begin his work. I remember very well that he was always careful about washing his clothes out every night. I would come in and find a group of students in the living area of Dr. Mishra's apartment, and in the bathroom would be hung Swamiji's orange robes." So this picture is because Srila Prabhupada, understanding that their philosophies were completely on different ends of the yoga spectrum, and because Dr. Mishra wouldn't allow him to speak, he needed a place of his own. So Dr. Mishra very kindly, about 7 blocks away from his apartment, he had a hatha yoga studio. And that hatha yoga studio had one small little private room and a washroom attached to it, no windows. But he allowed Prabhupada to stay in that little room. And this is the building that Prabhupada stayed in. By winter 1966, Prabhupada began to feel cramped at the yoga studio on 72nd Street. It was, after all, just a small office space without furniture or telephone. The office was not a proper living space, but since Prabhupada insisted on a private place to stay, they made an exception just for him. Austerely sleeping on the floor on blankets while planning the future of a movement that was yet to be, he would chant and read and entertain guests whenever possible. So when Prabhupada did move there, because there was no facility for cooking in that room, every morning after Prabhupada did his sadhana in the morning, he would walk 7 blocks to Dr. Mishra's apartment and cook for them both. And later we'll hear how Joan, when they would go to the country ashram, all of the students loved to have some of the prasadam Prabhupada was cooking, and they tried to learn from him as well. This is that ashram. Srila Prabhupada would sometimes discuss with Dr. Mishra the aim of his visit to America, expressing his spiritual master's vision of establishing Krishna consciousness in the West. He requested Dr. Mishra to help him, but Dr. Mishra would always refer to his own teaching work, which kept him very busy, and to his plans for leaving the country soon. After a few weeks, when it became inconvenient to maintain Prabhupada at the apartment, Dr. Mishra shifted him to his Hatha Yoga studio on the fifth floor of 100 West 72nd Street near Central Park. The large studio was located in the center of the building and included an office and an adjoining private room where Prabhupada stayed. It had no windows. Philosophically, at complete odds with Prabhupada, Dr. Mishra accepted the absolute truth in the impersonal feature, or Brahman, to be supreme. Prabhupada stressed the supremacy of the personal feature, or Bhagavan, following the Vedic theistic philosophy that the most complete understanding of the absolute truth is personal. The Bhagavad Gita says that the impersonal Brahman is subordinate to Bhagavan and is an emanation from him, just as the sunshine is an emanation from the sun planet. This conclusion has been taught by the leading traditional acharyas of ancient India, such as Ramanuja and Madhva, and Srila Prabhupada was in disciplic succession from Madhva. Dr. Mishra, on the other hand, followed Shankara, who taught that the impersonal presence of the absolute truth is all in all, and that the personality of Godhead is ultimately an illusion. Whereas Prabhupada's theistic philosophy accepted the individual spiritual self, Atma, as an eternal servant of the supreme spiritual being, Bhagavan. Dr. Mishra's view accepted the spiritual self as not an individual. Rather, his idea was that since each person is identical with God, the supreme Brahman, there is no need to worship God outside oneself. As Dr. Mishra would put it, everything is one. So we can just imagine the inconvenience, both on Dr. Mishra's side and particularly on Srila Prabhupada's side, of having to hear all of this nonsense that Dr. Mishra was teaching to his students. But Prabhupada was being very patient because he had a mission and he had to find the right via medium by which he could begin his movement. Now, we can study Srila Prabhupada since the time he left India. He first suffered a lot of adi-daivic inconveniences beyond his control, such as the seasickness, the storms, the inability to eat. And finally, when he got to America and he went to Butler, then he experienced the, what Satsuru Maharaj calls it, the, in Butler he had been confined by his host's middle class sensibilities. So Prabhupada was learning, just as all over the world, human beings have a tendency. They want to be part of a group, and therefore they choose to conform to the group's, the peer group's values. So even in the case of Gopal Agarwal, who came from the Braj area, his father's name was Mathura Prasad Agarwal. Prabhupada met him in Agra while preaching. So Gopal obviously came from a very religious background here in the Brudge area. But when he went to America, in order to fit in or conform to American lifestyle, his wife was cooking meat, his daughter was going to the Christian Sunday school. This was also that they could fit in. And at that time, they were very concerned that Prabhupada didn't start any missionary activities. So Prabhupada was also confined there. Then, after that, he had just a small taste of the academia in America, how the Sanskrit department head did not even know Sanskrit. And these were the biggest scholars of America. And Prabhupada, he saw that a lot of work had to be done even amongst the so-called experts in America. Now, his next challenge was, going to New York, he had to face and live with an impersonalist Shankarite. So Prabhupada, he was getting a very good taste of what the opposition was going to be in his preaching in America. Sometimes Prabhupada would journey upstate to Ananda Ashram, a yoga establishment of 60 peaceful acres in the foothills of the Catskills Mountains. Dr. Mishra had founded the ashram in 1964, that was just a year before. And while there, Prabhupada would engage in his usual activities of kirtan and lecturing. By so doing, he naturally endeared himself to many of the retreat's residents and visitors. Of course, the students of Dr. Mishra, being innocent, they were searching for spiritual life. And at that time, there were no bhakti yogis in America. The best they could find was impersonalism until Prabhupada began his preaching and kirtan. Joan Suval, who most of this information is coming from, a young disciple of Dr. Mishra, was deputed to meet Prabhupada at the Port Authority bus terminal, where he would be coming in from Philadelphia, and escort him to an Indian festival in the heart of the city. Now, this information, we have to thank Satyaraj Prabhu and Yadubara, because they both met with Joan Suval, and they got more information about her interactions with Srila Prabhupada and her impressions of him. Satsrut Maharaj has put somewhat of what she said, but then they did two Back to Godhead articles where she went into much more detail, and we were able to find those and are sharing them in this slideshow. Joan Suval says, "I was always relaxed with Swami Bhaktivedanta. The ashram was open only on the weekends. So we would come out Friday night driving Swamiji and Guruji," that's Prabhupada and Dr. Mishra, "and our son, and then on Sunday night come back. Early on, I was given the name of Mother of the Ashram. So if I were Mother of the Ashram, and I was only in my 30s, then Swami Bhaktivedanta had to be the grandfather of the ashram." And that was how they saw him. The two Swamis became quite close and could talk for hours on end, not just about Indian philosophy and culture, but on just about every other subject as well. Prabhupada insisted that having a place of his own would be essential for pushing forward his mission, whether at Riverside Drive, that was the apartment of the Swami, or on 72nd Street. Joan loved listening to them talk, although sometimes it was in Hindi, which she couldn't understand. Still, she would watch their animated conversations nonetheless. Their talks were often full of serious back and forth, if also peppered with hearty laughter. Through it all, they became intimate friends, and Joan was happy to be at their beck and call. Now, there's a very interesting thing that happens after that. She was happy to be at their beck and call. She used to be their chauffeur. She would bring them to and from the ashram, and she always liked watching them and hearing what they were saying. One such call came in soon after Prabhupada's arrival. Dr. Mishra had made regular trips to the World Fair, which was popular throughout the New York tri-state area, with reverberations extending around the world. He wanted to take Prabhupada to see it too. So this World Fair, 1964 and 1965, did you attend it? No. We attended it. I was 10 years old. I very vividly remember it. It was one of the biggest, it was like the Kumbh Mela in India. Millions of Americans came from all over to see this World Fair. I have some pictures of it. Yes, there. And it had... You could, for days and days, just as Dr. Mishra did, days and days you can go looking at all the exhibits. And the main exhibits were on science. And because it was 1965, there were very, very few computers. So the biggest exhibition was IBM, International Business Machine Corporation. They were just starting computers. And people were afraid of computers. So they had these huge walk-in exhibitions where you got to know how computers worked. And the other one was General Motors. They make all the cars. And they created an entire futuristic city. And they had, I remember as a 10-year-old, the impressions that for the first time in our life we saw, now it's all over the place. You go into an airport and they have these moving passageways. You just stand on it and move. So they had that, which was so modernistic. No one had ever seen anything like it. And you would just stand on it and walk, you know, it would take you to all the different exhibitions. And because they wanted interaction, they would have the children do all kinds of experiments. And I had a souvenir that they gave me. They had created artificial leather. So they gave all the children little pieces of this artificial, you know, just my memories. And here, now Dr. Mishra was bringing Prabhupada to this fair.
He's in Flushing Meadows.
Yes, it was in Flushing. Yeah, it was just outside of New York City. It's huge, huge. During Prabhupada's earliest days in America, his host took him for a little-known outing. Prabhupada went to the 1965 World's Fair. The fair ran for 2 6-month seasons, 1964 and 1965, with extensions well into 1966. It was so popular. So Satyaraj, he estimated that Prabhupada went, of course, in 1965, because this was already September, October. That day at the fair, I remember watching Swamiji as I would a child. I liked him very much, and I worried sometimes because he seemed to be carrying the weight of the world on his shoulders. Seriousness appeared to be his constant companion. But that day, at the fair, it was wonderful to just watch him, full of energy, smiling, even laughing at times. He seemed to be an excited child, wanting to see every pavilion, every exhibit. I watched him listening attentively when Sri Brahmananda, that's Dr. Mishra, pointed out and remarked about a small sculpture from an ancient civilization, a man, legs crossed, meditating. Both he and Sri Brahmananda liked the science pavilion the best. They spent a lot of time in there. And again, Swamiji listened to Sri Brahmananda as he explained the special exhibits that represented the future as we would come to know it. So the lifestyle that we have now is what we were seeing then, 1965, that was 70 years ago. Video telephone calls, it was just... Even when we saw it as children and as Prabhupada saw it, we didn't believe that it would actually happen. But now we're experiencing all of that now. And futuristic cities, living in these big towers and cars that fly and all these things that are happening now or will be happening in the future. Swamiji even purchased an item from one of the vendors. And I remember him showing it to me, obviously delighted that he had found something he needed. It was a small handmade tote bag that he could use for carrying items such as keys, etc. In short, the World's Fair of 1965 was a happy experience for Swamiji. I'm convinced he actually had fun that day. So apparently Satsrup Maharaj didn't know about that fun day that Prabhupada had. Okay. Now we'll go back to what Satsrup Maharaj is saying here. We were just saying, Dr. Mishra was just put, he just put it in a nutshell, his philosophy, everything is one. Prabhupada challenged, if each of us is actually the Supreme, then why is this Supreme suffering and struggling in the material world? Dr. Mishra would counter, that the Supreme is only temporarily covered by illusion, and that through Hatha Yoga and meditation, one would become enlightened, understanding it is all the Supreme. Prabhupada would again challenge, but if the Supreme could be covered by illusion, then illusion would be greater than God, greater than the Supreme. Prabhupada considered Dr. Mishra a Mayavadi because of his inadvertent acceptance that Maya, or illusion, is greater than the absolute truth. For Srila Prabhupada, not only was the impersonal philosophy unpalatable, it was an insult to the personality of Godhead. So imagine Prabhupada having to live with such a person. But at least Dr. Mishra, he was getting purified by taking prasadam every day. According to Krishna in the Bhagavad Gita 7:24 and 9:11, unintelligent men who know me not think that I have assumed this form and personality. Due to their small knowledge, they do not know my higher nature, which is changeless and supreme. Fools deride me when I appear in this human form. They do not know my transcendental nature and my supreme dominion over all that be. Lord Chaitanya had also strongly refuted the Mayavad philosophy. This is a quote from Lord Chaitanya. Everything about the Supreme Personality of Godhead is spiritual, including his body, opulence, and paraphernalia. Mayavad philosophy, however, covers his spiritual opulence and advocates the theory of impersonalism. Has anyone here ever tried to argue with an impersonalist?
It could be obstinate.
Yeah, very obstinate. Unfortunately, I had to stay with one once as a house guest, and she was telling me this Mayavad philosophy. She's saying, we're all God. And just as Krishna has his Leela, we also are having our Leela. The poor woman, unfortunately, was dying of cancer. So what type of a Leela is that? So that's why Krishna says, unintelligent men, fools deride me. They can't understand, and unfortunately, their gurus are misguiding them in this Mayavad philosophy. Before coming to America, Srila Prabhupada had written in his Bhagavatam purports, the ambitious Mayavadi philosophers desire to merge into the existence of the Lord. This form of mukti, liberation, means denying one's individual existence. In other words, it is a kind of spiritual suicide. It is absolutely opposed to the philosophy of Bhakti Yoga. Bhakti Yoga offers immortality to the individual conditioned soul. If one follows the Mayavad philosophy, he misses his opportunity to become immortal after giving up the material body. In the words of Lord Chaitanya, Mayavadi Krishna Aparadi. Mayavadi impersonalists are great offenders unto Lord Krishna. So although Dr. Mishra was a Mayavadi, he assisted Srila Prabhupada, so he was benefited in that way. Thus Lord Chaitanya had concluded that if one even hears the commentary of Shankara, one's entire spiritual life is spoiled. Dr. Mishra was content to align himself with the philosophy of Shankara and allow Prabhupada to stay with Lord Krishna and the Bhagavad Gita. But Srila Prabhupada pointed out that even Shankara accepted that the personality of Godhead, Krishna, or Narayan, exists eternally beyond the material world. Therefore, he is a transcendental person. Narayana paro vyaktat. Bajagovinda, 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 mudha mate. This is the IBM's theater. All the people waiting in line here to see this big show of science exhibition. They go into this big, it's called an ovoid theater. This is what Prabhupada's experience. So now more of Joan Suval's memories. My memories of him, meaning Prabhupada, were mostly of him smiling and laughing, because when he was with Sri Brahmananda, then Dr. Mishra, he carried on in Hindi, and they usually ended up in total laughter. After the program of Vedantic readings and chanting, Guruji would turn over the latter part of the evening to Swamiji. He would try to caution him, and he'd say, Swamiji, only 15 minutes remaining. At most 20 minutes, Swamiji. And Swamiji would look at him very sincerely and say, I know, people need to rest. It is late. I will do little bit chanting. But it was to no avail, because once Swamiji went into that divine chanting, the bhakti chanting, he lost all sense of time and space every time he chanted. And it was seldom that it was less than 1 hour. And Guruji knew it. It was his joke with Swami Bhaktivedanta. He was serious only when he was chanting or talking about Krishna consciousness. But when he was relating to people, and certainly relating to Guruji, his face would light up and he had a radiance because he was happy. When Swamiji was happy, it showed. I guess because he did a lot of traveling on his own, he had become self-sufficient in the kitchen, and he also loved, absolutely loved, to make meals for Guruji, and he would make a lot of food. So we know how important both preparing and honoring prasadam is. In fact, in our Guru Vastakam, it's even mentioned that the spiritual master is happy when he sees the devotees taking the four different types of prasadam together. So it's very much a part of the philosophy to honor prasadam, and that honoring prasadam, it becomes prasadam by the mentality with which it's prepared and then offered to Krishna. So Prabhupada, this was transcendental trickery. Although he was surrounded by the Mayavadi philosophy, he was able to purify all these people by very carefully offering prasadam and having everyone honor the prasadam together. So we knew when Swamiji was cooking that he could serve about 20 people, although he was cooking mainly for Guruji. We would gather around as he was cooking. We wanted to learn from him what he was doing. So we would ask him questions, and he wouldn't answer because he'd be totally absorbed in his moment-to-moment activity. We never talk when we're cooking because we have to, first of all, even the talking could contaminate what we're preparing, and we have to fully concentrate. It's total meditation when you're cooking. When I would cook for Prabhupada, I'd always be completely alone so that you could just 100% meditate on every single thing you're doing for efficiency. And Prabhupada was the same way. We learned that from Prabhupada. Although we were in a happy mood because we were anticipating a lovely meal and being with the two of them, he just remained serious until the last morsel was being finished. He was just one-pointed in everything he did. I always felt about him that he was a deeply serious man, serious about life. He never talked about his past, his personal life. I did ask him once or twice a question here and there, and he waved it away. He said, "Not important, that's not important." And then I began to feel it wasn't important. What was important was what he was doing now. It was only once when he touched me so much, touched meaning by his behavior on a spiritual platform, I asked if I could hug him. He said something like, "Why not?" Nobody touched him usually. Guruji did. He would put his arm around him. But this was after I knew him for a while. Of course, she was like a granddaughter to Srila Prabhupada. But it was the Indian way of hugging. Somehow they managed to hug you and be miles apart in that hug. But at the same time, although the bodies were kept apart, It's only really the shoulders that come together. It's Indian style. But I felt Swamiji's love. So Prabhupada was being very kind and merciful to these poor children of his who were being misguided. He was trying to give them as much mercy as possible while he was with them in the yoga studio, at the yoga ashram. He was a tender man, and he was a caring man, and an innocent man. And in the company of innocency, you relax completely. And so I was always relaxed with Swami Bhaktivedanta. Okay, we'll go on now with what Satsrup Maharaj is saying. A mendicant, Prabhupada was temporarily dependent on the goodwill of his Mayavadi acquaintance, with whom he regularly ate and conversed, and from whom he accepted shelter. But what a great inconvenience it was. He had come to America to speak purely and boldly about Krishna, but he was being restricted. In Butler, he had been confined by his host's middle-class sensibilities. Now he was silenced in a different way. He was treated with kindness, but he was considered a threat. Dr. Mishra could not allow his students to hear the exclusive praise of Lord Krishna as the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Imagine how unfortunate because of this Mayavad philosophy. Spending most of his time in his new room, Srila Prabhupada kept at his typing and translating. But when Dr. Mishra held his yoga classes, Prabhupada would sometimes come out and lead a kirtan or lecture. Now we have a memory from one of Prabhupada's earliest students named Robert Nelson. Robert Nelson was one of Prabhupada's first young sympathizers in New York. I went to Dr. Mishra's service, and Dr. Mishra talked. Swamiji was sitting on a bench, and then all of a sudden, Dr. Mishra stops the service. He gets a big smile and says, Swamiji will sing us a song. I think Dr. Mishra wouldn't let him speak. Somebody told me Dr. Mishra didn't want him to preach. Every morning, several hours before dawn, Prabhupada would rise, take his bath, chant Hare Krishna on his beads, and work at his translating while outside his closed-in windowless chamber, dawn came and the city awoke. He had no stove, so daily he had to walk 7 blocks to the Riverside Drive apartment to cook. It would be late morning when he would come out onto the busy street. He would walk north on Columbus. I think we have this map here. Yes. The red ball is where Prabhupada's place was, and he would have to go towards the river 7 blocks to get to the apartment. He would walk north on Columbus Avenue amid the steady flow of pedestrians, pausing at each intersection in the sweeping breeze from the river. Instead of the small town scenery of Butler, he passed through the rows of 30-story office buildings on Columbus Avenue. At street level were shoe repair shops, candy stores, laundries, and continental restaurants. The upper stories held the professional suites of doctors, dentists, and lawyers. So we once had, while we were preaching in New York, we once had to stay in this part of New York City. And first of all, the traffic in New York is 24 hours, even in the middle of the night. And you're locked up in these concrete buildings, 20, 30 stories high, and Prabhupada calls the apartments pigeonholes, just like the pigeons that go into a little place and live. So one time there was, you know, when you go to a zoo and you're looking at the different animals and they have a description of the animal's habitat and their different way of living, the tiger, what he does, where he lives, the fox. So they, as a spoof they had a human being with a description. And they described that what happens in childhood, and then when they mature, they find a mate, and they find a cement box to live in. So this is the way New York life is up in this uptown, where the uptown swamis are. Everyone in these tall buildings, in these little cement cubicles, their apartments, and then they come out onto the streets. There's never any quiet, never any peace, never any fresh air. They have Central Park where they can walk in if they want to risk their lives. So New York life is quite difficult, but Prabhupada explains that there's a class of people, they're born in New York, and they never leave New York City. It's their karma, because they're so attached to life within New York. It's like a whole universe in itself. So Prabhupada was experiencing that now. He was having to walk these 7 blocks through these tall buildings. You don't even see the sun. And then go over towards the river. At 75th Street, he would turn west and walk through a neighborhood of brownstone apartments. That's brownstone apartments is where the wealthier people live. It's just about 3 stories high. And then across Amsterdam to Broadway. So you can see Broadway in this map. And in between Broadway, we have them here in India, the green strips. In the highways, they always keep a strip in between, so there's a little bit of greenery. So this is the only street like that in all of... they had one street called Broadway that had the green strip. But here's what Satsarupamrita says about it. With its center island park, the greenery here could more accurately be described as blackery, since it was covered with soot and city grime. Broadway displayed its produce shops and butcher shops with their stands extending onto the sidewalk, and old men sat on batches in the thin strip of the park between the northbound and southbound traffic. The last block on 75th before Riverside Drive held high-rise apartment buildings with doormen standing. 33 Riverside Drive also had a doorman. So I'm just going to finish now because we just have 2 minutes, and there's a little bit more here that's not in the Lilamrita. What finally happened is because Dr. Mishra was also a medical doctor, but he had given up his profession, he had about 25 people living, his students, in his ashram. And his students had a 3-year-old son who had a kidney disorder and was on medication. And he had the mother stop giving the child the medication, and he was doing acupuncture on this little child, and the child died. So he was captured by the police and put in jail. And the residents of the ashram, they considered it to be a setup because the government, and this was alluded to by Satsarupa Maharaj, the government actually didn't like these yoga societies. And they were coming, they had applied for zoning to expand their buildings, and the council in that area didn't want to give that permission. In fact, they were even saying that it's not a religious society, so they shouldn't be allowed to expand. And then they put Dr. Mishra into jail. And not only did they put him into jail for second-degree murder, but they put him into jail for practicing as a doctor when his license had expired. So he got into big trouble, ultimately. This is what happens. Now, when Prabhupada was here in 1977 in New York, there was a very big court case going on about the brainwashing, whether the International Society for Krishna Consciousness was stealing and brainwashing the youth of America and turning them into robotic followers, just brainwashing them. So Prabhupada, he wanted to make his last trip to America, And he was expressing that if I go now, they're looking for the old man. It was him. Because ISKCON, the Hare Krishna Society, had become so world famous by that time, and so many youth were joining, that they wanted to capture Prabhupada and implicate him in something. So what happened was Prabhupada and the devotees, they maintained pure Krishna consciousness during the entire court trial. They went as devotees. In the courtroom, they set up a whole display of Prabhupada's books. They had so many backings from hundreds of scholars and religious leaders in India, proving that this is not a new religion, it's not a fad, it's thousands of years old, we have all of the scriptures. And they won the case. And on the front page of the New York Times, it was stated there that the Hare Krishnas win the case. And Prabhupada had us take that article, frame it, and put it at the front of the temple here. Yes. So.
And in all the temples.
Oh, it was in all the temples also? Oh, one, I didn't know that. I only knew about this temple. So.
It was a great victory.
Yes, it was a great victory. Up to the Supreme Court, it was a victory. This was the High Court of New York, but it was a statement then that could be used in other cases. So in this case, Dr. Mishra didn't win. He was put into jail, actually. And this is the difference between taking full shelter of Krishna. When you're doing Krishna's service, then he gives you full protection like this. So the devotees won the case, and we'll hear more about Prabhupada's trials and tribulations starting the Hare Krishna movement in America. Hare Krishna. Jai. Let me see if there's anything more after this. No, that's all. Okay.